everybody. Thank you, Dr. Elamogun, for the kind introduction, and I want to thank all of you for being here, both in person and online. My name is Rose Wang. I'm a rising senior here at UW, and I have the privilege and honor this summer to be working with Dr. Kalume in the Kalume Lab at the Seattle Children's Center for Integrated Brain Research. My presentation will be on the impact of NDUS4 knockout mutations on neuronal excitability in a mouse model of Leigh syndrome. So Leigh syndrome is a progressive neurodegenerative disorder that causes symmetrical bilateral lesions in various regions of the brain, such as the basal ganglia, both the caudate nucleus and the putamen, and the brainstem. This figure on the right is an MRI scan of a child with Leigh syndrome, and lesions in the putamen and the nucleus accumbens are clearly visible. Leigh syndrome is also characterized by the gradual loss of mental and movement abilities accompanied by epilepsy. While the clinical presentation of Leigh syndrome has large variability, Leigh syndrome normally causes death within 2 to 3 years, typically from respiratory failure. In many cases, Leigh syndrome is associated with loss of function mutations in complex 1 of the electron transport chain. One of these mutations occurs in NADH dehydrogenase ubiquinone iron sulfur protein 4, or NDUS for short, which is a gene which codes for a subunit of complex 1. And loss of function mutations in NDUS4 have been associated with Leigh syndrome. To study Leigh syndrome, a mouse model with NDUS4 knockouts can be created. However, NDUS4 knockout mutations in specific neuron types will cause different effects in the mice, which together can model Leigh syndrome. As shown in the figure, mice with an NDUS4 knockout in GABAergic or inhibitory neurons exhibit a seizure phenotype, shown in this EEG recording, which shows a spontaneous GTC seizure, while mice with an NDUS4 knockout in glutamatergic or excitatory neurons have motor impairments and respiratory dysfunction. This trace here shows a wild-type mouse with very regular breathing patterns as opposed to the knockout mouse, which has irregular breathing abnormalities. So in a wild-type mouse, the overall activity of the neural network is balanced through levels of excitatory and inhibitory neural activity. We hypothesized that GAD-free mutant mice, which have an NDUS4 knockout in their GABAergic neurons, will lead to hyperexcitation of excitatory neurons and overall hyperexcitation of the neural network. On the other hand, V-glute-free mutant mice, which have NDUS4 knockouts in their glutamatergic neurons, are hypothesized to have overall hypoexcitation of the neural network. To test our proposed hypothesis, we generated mutant and control GAD-free and V-glute-free mice. Using LOX-P-Cre technology, which knocks out the gene of interest when Cre is present, we generated a GAD-Cre mutant mouse with the NDUS4 knockout, as well as a control mouse without the knockout, since Cre is not present in the control. Similarly, we generated a V-glute-Cre mutant mouse with the NDUS4 knockout, as well as a control without the knockout, because Cre is not present. To quantify the amount of neural activity present in mouse brain tissue, we utilized immunohistological techniques in which the CFOS protein was labeled. So CFOS is an intermediate early gene expressed in neurons following intense activation and is related to signal cascades involved in neuronal plasticity and cell growth. In this experiment, CFOS was utilized to quantify spontaneous activity 30 minutes prior to perfusion following NDUS4 knockout mutations in excitatory and inhibitory neurons. The figure here on the right shows a general schematic of how the immunohistochemistry worked. We essentially used a series of antibodies, shown here as the primary and secondary antibody, to attach a fluorescent molecule called a fluorophore to the antigen, which in this case is CFOS. So I have some preliminary images here. Since GAD-Cre mutant mice have a seizure phenotype, we decided for this presentation to focus on the hippocampus, since the hippocampus has been known to be the site of seizure generation. Other areas of seizure generation, such as the cortex, will be analyzed at a later date. So these images were taken on an Olympus slide scanner with the GAD-Cre control mouse on the left and the GAD-Cre mutant mouse on the right. The mutant mouse clearly shows increased CFOS labeling here throughout the dentate gyrus, and the majority of the neurons present in the dentate gyrus are excitatory. And this increase in spontaneous activity in the hippocampus of the GAD-Cre mutant mouse may explain their seizure phenotype. Since the V-glute-Cre mutant mouse show both motor impairment and respiratory dysfunction, we decided to focus on the cerebellum, which coordinates motor movements, as well as the pre-Botzinger complex, which controls respiration. So So these images were taken on an LSM confocal microscope with the V-loop-free control mouse on the left and the mutant mouse on the right. So these images right here are of the cerebellum. And in the cerebellum, the control mouse has the Purkinje cells here, clearly labeled, indicating that they were active. In comparison, the mutant mouse shows decreased activity in the Purkinje cells. This lack of activity in the Purkinje cells, which are the sole output of the cerebellum, may contribute to the motor impairment and ataxia. Next, we took a look at the pre-Boxinger complex, which is located in the brainstem. Once again, the V-loop-free mutant mouse shows decreased activity in the pre-Boxinger complex, as shown as decreased labeling, which may contribute to the respiratory dysfunction. Overall, the GAD-free mutant mice showed increased activity in hippocampal neurons, and this increase in spontaneous activity in GAD-free mutant mice may contribute to their seizure phenotype. In comparison, the V-glucree mutant mice showed decreased activity in both the cerebellar Purkinje neurons, which may contribute to their ataxia and motor impairment, as well as in pre-Boxinger neurons, which may contribute to the respiratory dysfunction. The next steps in this experiment include utilizing ImageJ, which is a cell counting software, to quantify the amount of active neurons in a given image. To help us determine if CFOS-labeled cells are excitatory or inhibitory neurons, we will use conditional knockout mice where targeted neurons are labeled with TD tomato using AI-14. So TD tomato is a fluorescence, and it will cause the interneurons to fluoresce red. We can then compare the CFOS-labeled images with the TD tomato expression and categorize the CFOS-labeled cells into either inhibitory or excitatory neurons. All in all, these results will potentially help understand the cell-specific mechanisms for the development of seizures and Leigh syndrome, as well as help develop potential mechanism-based therapies for those with LS. I'd like to say a huge thank you to everyone who has supported me throughout the NSSSP. I could not have done it without